Hi, my name is Roger. I work for Citrix on the open source Zen project. And I'm here today to introduce a talk about how to tune Zen to obtain the best performance. Has anyone here used Zen in the past? Yeah? Well, not that. Yeah, well, I wanted also to speak a little bit about the status of CentOS and Zen, because my initial idea was to do a live demo of CentOS 7 running Zen, but the package are not ready yet, I've been told, and I fall back to a more generic talk about performance and Zen. And then I have a video of CentOS 7 running Zen on ARM 64. Which should be a little bit more interesting. It's just a video, because I don't have hardware here in order to do that. But I've been told that the packages are ready for ARM64, but they are not ready for x86, which is kind of strange, because everyone will guess that x86 is much
I can explain why.
Easier? Yeah?
No, because they're, at the moment, George built the package on cbs.centos.org, which is the Kurji build farm, which has a bunch of steps to get through. While ARM64 is not added yet to the build system there. Okay. So that's one of the guys from CentOS working directly with him just to build directly the package on the other machine. To bypass completely the Koji system, because Koji is not ARM64 aware yet in our build farm.
Okay.
That's the only reason.
Yeah, so that's the thing. I'm going to show a demo later of ARM64, but we can speak a little bit about Zen also, especially if there are users here that use Zen from time to time. I would like to start, I always start with this slide, because it's very different from other hypervisors in general. This is the architecture of a Zen system usually, which is a type 1 hypervisor. Here we have all the hardware. Then we have Zen on top of that, which is a microkernel that runs directly on top of the hardware. And then we have the guest on top of that. Zen itself is not an operating system, so it doesn't have drivers, it doesn't have a command line, it doesn't have anything like that. So in order to control the hypervisor, in order to control Zen, we create what's called a control domain. This domain is created when Zen is starting. Zen starts and then it creates the first guest, which is called the control domain. It has some special features. It has control over the hypervisor itself and is able to create guests, for example. So in this slide, I have a typical Zen system, which is the hardware, Zen running on top, then the control domain, and then a couple of guests. I also added some task there to compare between a type 1 hypervisor and a type 2 hypervisor. Here we can see that Zen only manages the guest, and then each guest has its own task or applications or program or whatever that run inside of the guest. Then if we compare that to a type 2 hypervisor, that would be something like KVM or VirtualBox or these kind of hypervisors. You have the hardware, you have the operating system that contains the hypervisor itself, and then you have the task that usually run inside of an operating system, and then you also have the guest. In this case, if we compare with the previous slide, you can see that here tasks are inside of the guest itself, while here tasks compete with the guest for resources. The scheduler has to schedule the task that you usually run on your control domain or on your host together with the guest. I believe that this is not really efficient, because on Zen, for example, we have specific schedules. In order to manage VM, we have a lot of schedulers designed to schedule VMs only, not tasks. And it's also important to notice the fact that using a type 2 hypervisor, a guest, compete with applications in order to obtain resources. Zen started during the 90s as a project in the Cambridge University, together with Intel and Microsoft Labs. And during this project, they realized that it was not possible to virtualize x86. Well, that the x86 architecture was not easy to virtualize, and that the only options that you had at that point were either full software emulation or binary translation. Both of these options are very slow, they have a lot of overhead. So they decided that in order to improve that, the best way to do it was to make the operating system itself aware that it was running inside of a virtualized environment, let's say that way, and they design a new interface for virtualization. This interface replaces the interface that you would usually see on x86. It replaces some of the instructions. It replaces some of the things that usually have on x86. For example, on x86, you usually always have a CPI, you always have a local APIC, you always have a PIP. You always have quite a lot of hardware components that are not easy to virtualize. So they decided to get rid of all of these, and instead of using hardware emulation, they decided to introduce new interfaces that were prepared for virtualization and were much more lightweight in this sense. And the result of this is what we know today as paravirtualization, which is also used by other hypervisors, like Virtua.io is an example of paravirtualization. You replace an emulated hardware drive, for example, with Virtua.io, which is a paravirtualized hard drive. So when they started, they decided that, well, mostly everything had to be paravirtualized because the x86 and the native interfaces were not really easy to emulate, and they had a lot of overhead. So basically we have paravirtualized disk and network interfaces, the interrupts and the timers are also paravirtualized. The way the kernel boots is also different from the way it boots when it runs on bare metal. And then you also have to paravirtualize the memory management unit and some privileged instructions because they could not execute it, I guess. Well, this was a little bit of the, to get you into what paravirtualization is. I don't want to extend it a lot. If you have any questions about paravirtualization itself, you can ask, but it's, well, it's a big topic and it's really easy, really hard to put it only on one slide. Then x86 improved quite a lot with the introduction of the hardware virtualization extensions that can be found now on almost any x86 CPU. So with the introduction of that extensions, Xen was allowed to run unmodified guest. We usually call this guest HVM, and we usually call the paravirtualized guest PD to differentiate between them. HVM guest have emulated devices. These devices are emulated by PMU, and you can use, well, and from a guest point of view, it's like a bare metal computer. We don't need to use any PV interfaces if we don't want to. And this is a slide of the different guest modes that Xen supports. On the bottom, we have PV, which is the original mode, the mode that make Xen famous in this sense. And then on the other hand, we have HVM, which is a fully emulated virtual machine using hardware virtualization when possible. So here we can see that paravirtualized guests use PV interfaces for everything. They paravirtualize everything. And then HVM guest uses hardware virtualization for the privileged instructions and the base tables, and then it uses software virtualization for everything else. Here, software virtualization actually means QEMU. You have QEMU that handles all these devices using software virtualization. But it's possible to improve a little bit the performance of HVM guest. We can see here that we have two red squares, which means that performance here is kind of poor. So you can actually have an HVM guest that uses PV drivers for some things like the disk and the network. This is very similar to what KVM actually does. It creates an HVM guest and it allows you to use built-in interfaces. It's exactly the same that this. And then also, if you want to go one step further, you can also use paravirtualized interfaces for interrupts and timers. This allows us to get rid of mostly all the software virtualization inside of an HVM guest, because you're using the PV interfaces for disk and the PV interfaces for interrupts and timers. And then what you only need is the emulated boot sequence that's still emulated by software, because you have to boot the guest. You need an emulated BIOS mainly in order to boot the guest. Here I also have a list of different guest operating systems and the mode that you can run them when running on Xen. Linux, of course, supports running in all possible modes. Then for Windows, you can run it as an HVM guest using all the emulated hardware, using the emulated network card and the emulated disk. But you can also install PV drivers in order to obtain better network and disk performance. NetBSD is also the only other guest that can run as a pure PV guest. Then we have FreeBSD, which can run as a PVHDN guest, and finally the other BSD, which can only run as a HDN guest. I've been told that OpenBSD is trying to integrate PV drivers for distant network, so we will probably see a green square there sometime soon. Quite a lot of people wonder what's the...
PV drivers are specific for Shen? Or?
Yeah. You can also use Virt.io, but it doesn't perform that good. You can use Virt.io, and it's better than using the emulated disk or the emulated network controller, but it's not the native Zen protocol. The native Zen protocol is PV, paravirtualized drivers. It's usually called NetFront and BlockFront inside of guest. But, yeah. So quite a lot of people wonder, since we have a lot of options, for example, if you want to deploy a Linux guest, you can deploy it in all modes. Of course, in this case, it would only make sense to deploy it as a PV guest or as a PV HDN guest, because those are the modes that perform better. But quite a lot of people wonder whether they should use PV guest or PV HDN guest in order to create, to launch their appliances. In general, it's not easy to know which mode is going to perform better. You actually need to try, but I have some benchmarks here. For example, this is Kernbench, which is a benchmark that basically compiles the Linux kernel using a lot of threads and puts quite a lot of stress on the system. Lower here is the better, because that's time, so the lower the better. We can see, for example, that PVHDM using 64 bits is the one that performs better. Then we have PVHDM 32 bits, then we have HDM, and finally we have PV. PV is really slow when doing this. Why is PV really slow? Because PV has what we call a PV memory management unit, and when you create a lot of tasks, you have to interact a lot with the memory management unit in order to create the page tables, to destroy them. This is slow when using hypercodes. If you use HVM, you are not emulating anything, because that's taken care by the hardware virtualization extensions. There's a hardware virtualized memory management unit for each guest, so it's basically much more faster. Then, for example, I have another interesting one, which is SpecJBB. This is a Java benchmark. And here we can see that actually PV performs a little bit better than PV on HDN. They are mostly the same, because we can see that the variance here is quite high. This is a little bit lower, but this one is quite high, so they more or less perform the same. And finally, I have an iPerf benchmark. This is a network throughput benchmark. And here we can see more or less the same with SpecJBB, PV 64-bit and PV on HDN 64-bit more or less perform equally. And then we have all the other kind of guests. As we can see, pure HDN guests without PV drivers perform really bad in this case, because you're actually using the software-emulated network card. So as I said before, in general, when you want to choose your guest mode, you need to actually put the workload similar to what you plan to do, even if it's a synthetic workload. If you know that your workload is similar to Kernbench, or if you want to use disk.io only because you are launching a file or something like that, it's always better to try and decide then which kind of mode do you want to run with.
Just one question. How much Linux distribution are still supported directly as PV guest those days? Because not a lot, I guess.
I think mostly all, because you actually use, it used to be quite worse before, but since Linux 3.0, the PV support is inside of the kernel. So all the distributions usually ship kernels that have all the PV points, all the PV machinery inside. You can actually have a kernel that can boot on native, bare metal, boot on PV, boot as a DOM0, and it's always the same kernel. So distributions tend to use that. They compile everything in, and then you can decide which one you want to use. But in general, almost all distributions that I know of run as PV guest. Send us runs as a BB guest. Debian also runs as a BB guest. I don't know.
Well, from a CentOS 7 perspective, the problem is not really related to the kernel, but to pgrep, right? So the way to boot itself, the DOM U.
Yeah, the entry point is different than the native, but both can coexist in the same kernel. Oops. You don't actually need two different kernels, one for PB and one for bare metal, or one for PB, one for HVM, and one for bare metal. It's always inside of the same kernel, and as far as I know, all distributions tend to include everything in one kernel. It was way worse before Linux 3.0. You actually have to patch your kernel in order to run on Zen, because, well, those patches were never accepted upstream, because, well, for various reasons, the patches never made it upstream, and in the past it was quite hard to get a PB kernel, because you needed a specific Linux kernel, and then you need a specific patch set to apply on top of that kernel. Now this is all gone, and you can pick almost any kernel and run it as a PBS without issues. So, the control domain that I show you on the first slide, we usually call it the DOM0 because it's the first domain that's created. It's a guest, and it's domain 0 because it's the first guest that's created. And it's a little bit different from other guests, of course, because it has direct control over Zen itself, over the hypervisor. And it also runs certain tasks, for example, QEMU instances usually run inside of DOM0. You don't have to do it this way all the time. You can run QEMU instances inside of other domains. But in general, QEMU instances that do all the emulation on behalf of domains run in DOM0. You also have quite a lot of drivers in there, so it can easily become a bottleneck if it's not configured properly. The first option that you can use is called DOM0 mem. That's a Zen option that you pass to Zen when booting, like you do with the Linux kernel. You pass certain options to the kernel command line. You do the same with Zen. That's the only way you can pass options to Zen. And basically, we have one option that's called DOM0 mem that tells Zen how much memory to allocate for the control domain. This is important because if you don't set it, DOM0 will get all the memory of the system, and then it will go ballooning down memory in order to create create guest. Basically, you need to reduce the memory of DOM0 and then create a guest. This usually works. The only problem is that the Linux kernel in general has some tuning, mostly related to network things, but it does some tuning depending on the memory that it detects when it boots. So if you boot with 32 gigabytes of RAM, and then you create 30 guests, and you end up with 1 gigabyte on DOM0, it may be a problem because your network is tuned for 32 gigabytes of RAM, not for 1 gigabyte of RAM. So it's important that once you have a stable deployment, you set these options to match your requirements, basically. What else? Yeah, we also have another option to control the number of CPUs that are assigned to DOM0. In general, as I've said before, DOM0 gets access to all the CPUs, so if you have 32 CPUs on your system, DOM0 will get 32 CPUs. That may not be necessary in general. I mean, you want to assign CPUs to other guests also. So if you have big systems, you usually assign maybe 4 CPUs to DOM0, 2 CPUs to DOM0. At home, for example, I assign 1 CPU to DOM0 because my box only has 8 threads. So it doesn't make much sense to assign 8 CPUs to DOM0. Also, we have another option that calls DOM0 vCPU pin. This means that DOM0 vCPUs will be pinned to physical CPUs. So, the CPU 0 seen from the guest will run on the physical CPU 0 of the host, and so on. And you get all them matched together. In general, if you don't do this, vCPUs or CPUs inside of the guest will be scheduled to any physical CPU that's available. That may not seem that important, but it's interesting if you want to do some kind of partitioning. Let's say you want to assign 2 CPUs only to DOM0, so that DOM0 only runs on these 2 physical CPUs and nothing else runs on them. That's interesting because you get actually much lower latency doing that way, because DOM0 is always running. You don't schedule DOM0 for other guests, for example. And the last thing, which is not really related to performance, but in general, it's always recommended that you set up a serial cable in order to debug Zen. Zen, when booted, well, we'll see it in the video, Zen boots, and then it switches control to the control domain, DOM0. And then it completely lost the control of the VGA output. Zen is no longer able to output anything to the VGA because that's assigned to the first domain that's created, DOM 0. So if you get any kind of errors or anything like that, they won't show up on the VGA. You actually need the serial cable because Zen controls the serial and outputs messages there. So it's actually very interesting to have the serial cable set up. You can also use the USB debug port, but it's actually very hard to find. Well, in order to use the USB debug port, you need a special key that's called NET20DC, and it's impossible to find them because the company that was doing them went bankrupt and they cannot be found anywhere. So in general, you need a serial cable and an old modem. What else? Yeah, this is an example of the box that I have at home that usually they use for development purposes, so it's not really interesting because it only has 8 CPUs. Usually when you set up Zen, you set up usually on big boxes that maybe have 32 CPUs, but anyway. And I'm using exactly this command line in order to boot Zen. You can see the first thing that I do is to set up the serial console. COM1, this is the speed of the serial console. And then I'm telling Zen to output on COM1. On the serial console that I configured before. I'm also telling Zen to assign only 1 GB to DOM 0. I'm assigning 2 vCPUs to DOM 0, and I'm telling Zen that I want those vCPUs to be pinned to physical CPUs. This is a very simple command line. It doesn't have anything very specific in this case, and you can always find more information about command line parameters on the on the forum web page. This is also part of the of the Zen source code, so you can actually look at the source code and you will find the Zen file. Apart from this was about DOM 0, now I'm going to speak a little bit more about guest and how to tune them in order to obtain a little bit better performance in general. One of the first things is that if you want to obtain very good I/O performance, you need to use physical disk as backends for guest. Using Kakao is very nice, but it doesn't perform as good as if you are using an LVM partition. This is something that you cannot not avoid. I mean, even RAW files don't have the same performance as a RAW LVM volume. So if you want to do something that's stable, I would recommend that you use LVM, or if you have, you can also use ZFS, for example, which is also quite interesting in this sense. It will perform better than LVM, actually. And then it's also very important to take into account the number of physical CPU that you have on your box. More vCPUs than the physical CPUs on the host. This doesn't make any sense, but people still try to do it. So don't do that, please. Then about the vCPU pinning, as I said before, you can actually pin guest CPUs to run only on a certain set of physical CPUs. This is interesting in order to do partitioning. For example, on the command line that I had before for DOM 0, I was pinning DOM 0 vCPUs to physical CPUs. And in general, if you want to obtain low latency, you would want to assign physical CPUs to guest CPUs exclusively, so that you only have one guest running on each physical CPU. This is more like partitioning than actual VM, but it's also interesting. And in the guest config file, you can specify the physical CPUs you want your guest to run. For example, this is a sample command line that you would add to a guest config file. And you can see here I'm telling the guest that it can run on CPUs from 0 to 3, so 0, 1, 2, 3, on CPU 5, and then I'm preventing it from running on CPU 1. So we basically end up with the guest running on this set of CPUs. This is actually quite interesting that you can prevent guests from running on specific physical CPUs, because if you have DOM 0 pinned to CPU 0 on CPU 1, you would usually add you will prevent guests from running on CPU 0 and CPU 1 in order to allocate the CPUs only to DOM 0. Also, there are quite a lot of options that you can tune in the Zen scheduler for VMs. One of the most interesting ones is the weight. You can set the weight of a domain. All domains start with a weight of 256. This is the a standard weight of a domain. Then if you create one domain with 512 weight value, it will mean that it will run twice as often as this domain. It will get double the CPU time, basically. And well, you can tune that during runtime. You don't have to do that in the config file. You can do, but you can also set that using the command line. Yeah.
It's also good to raise the weight for the DOM zero if you have certain load problems.
Yeah, I'm not saying it here. Yeah, it's also a good option if you have DOM zero. Well, if you have either a lot of HVM guests and you have a lot of VMware instances running in DOM zero, or if you have guests that make that use a lot of I/O that's handled by DOM zero, you would want to increase its weight. I don't know. In general, maybe you can leave the default weight for the domains that you create and set DOM zero to 500 or 1,000, maybe even if you want. That's something that you need to tune in general. You can see it. It's very easy to see if you need more CPU weight or not. You just log into DOM zero, run top. If it's a stock, it means that you need more CPU power. And also, you can find a lot more of information in the Excel man page. And you can also, well, we also have HTML versions of the man pages online. And then I want to speak a little bit about something that's specific to Zen. You cannot do that with any other hypervisor. So this is, if you're not familiar with Zen, it may sound a little bit strange. Here I have a slide very similar to the first one. I have the hardware, I have the Zen hypervisor, I have the control domain, and I have a guest, only one guest in this case. And this is the PV transport protocol. We have Netfront and Blockfront, which has the PV drivers inside of the guest. And we have Netback and Blockback inside of the DOM zero. This will handle the I/O on behalf of the guest. Basically, the guest says, I want to read block 100 from my disk. This goes to Blockback. Blockback reads whatever it needs from the disk and gets the information back to the guest. This is the normal workflow in general, and we run all the backends inside of DOM zero by default, unless you specify something else, as we will see. Well, yeah, I also want to notice that now we are, this guest is directly connected to DOM zero, which means that you are actually, well, you have a little bit of surface of attack here for DOM zero, because you're actually interacting with DOM zero directly. So if exploit was found here, guests could take advantage of that in order to exploit DOM zero and obtain privileges or to crash the domain or do a denial of service attack, whatever. So how can we mitigate this? We know that there will be bugs, there are always bugs. How can we make this a little bit worse? By introducing what we call a driver domain. So now we can see that we have the same again, or guest, DOM zero, but then we have something that's called a driver domain. This domain basically is an unprivileged domain, it's no longer DOM zero, it's no longer a control domain, it cannot do anything else to other guests, for example. But you can run the backends here, and you can actually do PC pass-through and attach a physical device to this guest, so it has access to a physical disk or whatever, or has access to a physical network card that you do ISCSI from it, for example, in order to mount this. And then we can see that in this case, our guest is no longer connected to DOM zero. It doesn't have this surface of attack. Instead, it's connected to an unprivileged domain that we call the driver domain. And then if, for example, an exploit was found here, this guest could take over this domain, but could never take over DOM zero. This is important because it prevents quite a lot of attacks. But, of course, it's important for security, as I said before, and it's also important because you can offload some work from DOM zero. In this slide, we no longer have DOM zero taking care of the I/O. It's another domain that takes care of the I/O. What else? Yeah, now I have a little bit of specific information about HVM domains, but well, I'm not sure if that's very interesting. This one is a little bit more interesting. Basically, each HVM guest requires a VMware instances in order to do the driver, well, all the software emulation is done inside the VM in order to emulate your network card, your disk, everything else is done by VM. So if you have a lot of HVM domains and you have, well, you will end up with a lot of VM instances on DOM 0. These are actually the processes that take CPU time on DOM 0. So what we can do is launch the VM process on a different domain that's not DOM 0. This is also interesting because you reduce the surface of attack once more and allows to offload work from DOM 0. For example, this is the typical setup that we said before. In this case, we have an HVM guest and the control domain. The control domain is running VM on behalf of the guest in order to emulate all the software, or all the hardware. So what we can do is launch a very small domain that's called stop domain that will basically run QEMU. It will only run QEMU. It's not an actual operating system. It's what we call a stop domain that runs a very specific kernel that's called Mini OS. It's a kernel that only runs on top of Xen. You cannot run that kernel on bare metal. And it's everything compiled inside of the kernel. You actually have a very small kernel and QEMU all compiled as a single binary that you launch and that's a domain. And actually, in this case, VM is running here. You have your HVM domain, and everything is completely isolated. If, for example, an exploit is found in VM, which happens quite often, we had quite a lot of exploits in VM recently, regarding, one was about floppy emulation, that you could actually exploit VM quite badly.
VNum.
We had quite a lot of problems with that. So by putting this inside of a completely different domain, well, yeah, you can use the exploit, you will take over this domain, but that's all. That's a very small domain that maybe has 32 megabytes of RAM, and that's all. There's nothing much you can do there. On the other hand, if you were running that here in the control domain and an exploit is found, you can take over the control domain, and that's very bad. Well, and as a conclusion, as we saw, and maybe some of you were a little bit tripped by this because there are quite a lot of little things in Xen that offer, well, I would say that it's quite complex in general, but it has a lot to offer in general. And yeah, that's mostly it. I will go with the, well, if you have questions about this, if not, I will go with the video and the demo about ARM64. I don't work on ARM, by the way, I do x86 only, so this video, well, I will try my best to explain what's going on, because it's very generic, but maybe some of you know more about ARM than myself. Yeah, ah, look fine. So, here we are connecting to an ARM64 box that's called TRAP. It's running CentOS 7 on ARM64. This is what the ARM people decide to call ARM64. I don't know why, but that's the technical name of the architecture. It's ARM64, and it's running a 3.19 kernel. And it's running CentOS also 7.1. I don't think the last number really matters. I don't know if it's the latest build or not, but what? No. CentOS 7. Then using Yum, we install the generic Xen packages. That's called, it's CentOS release Xen, which is in here, and it's the ARM64 package. This box, by the way, well, we are now installing, well, we added the repository and now we are installing all the packages. We can see that it's installing a new kernel, it's installing a bunch of grab files. This is because, as far as I know, we need a different kernel in order to run on Xen, but that's something related to CentOS because Red Hat doesn't want to put the Xen options inside of the kernel, so we need to recompile the kernel in order to obtain the Xen options, but these kind of things. Yeah, by the way, this is DuckTalBox. It's an APM, Applied Micro, Xgene Mustang, it's called. It's a 64-bit ARM box. And I think it has something like 8 gigabytes of RAM per node, because it's one of those boxes that has several blades on it, and you can put several boxes inside of one. So yeah, well, now it's installing all the packages. It will take a little bit. Well, not much actually, but kind of hard to skip on this one. Well, I'm just gonna leave them installing. Oh, yeah. Okay, now it's doing the cleanup for the packages, and it's verifying everything that was installed. Now it's done. And now we also want to install the littered packages from the CentOS repository that also come with Zen support. So basically, I'm installing a libbird. There's not really a lot of things here, but it's the general libbird driver plus the Zen hypervisor bits. It's finishing. It's also installing the latest release of the Zen Hypervisor, that's 4.6, which was released 1 week ago. It's very new. Actually, this one here is still an RC, it's a release candidate. Now we have the final version, which is already uploaded as far as I know, and should be present in the CentOS repository now. Yeah, now it's just finishing installing libbird. The daemon and everything will have to reboot in order to boot into the Zen install. But before doing that, we'll do a little bit of group config. We can see here that the Zen package is already added command line for Zen. For example, by default, Zen on ARM64 with CentOS, it has a default of 2 GB of RAM and 4 vCPUs. This is something that you can tune, as we said before. You can assign the number of CPUs and memory that you want. And here we have to add a little quirk for this specific platform. This is only done on the APM Mustang Xgene. It's not needed anywhere else. But the firmware for this hardware doesn't specify a default serial console, so Zen doesn't know where to output. So we are basically telling Zen to use this node in order to output. This is something that's only needed on APM, Mustang, and it's something that will be fixed with the next firmware revision that comes to APM, to the Mustang. So it's, well, I'm just mentioning so that you know that this is not something that you actually need to do. You can just usually reboot, and it will be done. Well, after modifying the grub config, we have to reveal the grub config file. And now we are checking that everything went fine and that the command line that we added is actually showing here on our grub file. And yeah, here it is. We can see that we have the command line that was already there, plus the output for the serial console, and everything else is done by default by CentOS, so no surprises here. And now we are rebooting the system in order to boot into Zen. This command line that's used here, ZenUse, it's a command line that we use in order to connect to the serial consoles of the boxes. That's not something that you have at home, so we're just connecting to the serial console, nothing more. And now we see the box actually booting. As I said, this is the 8-gene. Now it's loading. This is the firmware, and we will switch to grub now. We see that grub has loaded Zen, has loaded the Linux kernel, and is loading the RAM disk now. And, well, yeah, this is the Zen output that you get before switching to the control domain. As we can see, those messages are prefixed with the Zen tag, which means that it's output from the Zen hypervisor, it's not output from the Linux kernel. And we basically see Zen booting. It's very fast, so it's gonna be, yeah, and now this is Linux booting already. We see it, we then boot it and switch it control to the control domain, and that's Linux booting already. Well, this is a normal CentOS Linux booting. Again, that's nothing really interesting here apart from the fact that you are booting as a TOM0, but from Linux point of view, it's more or less the same. We are also starting some Zen services here. That's the final part of the boot process, and we are basically starting ZenStore, which is a service that runs on TOM0 only. And we are also setting DOM0 name, for example, so that you can see the name when you type the list of domains, things like that, but it's very fast. We are also creating a bridge in order to use it for guest. And yeah, we already booted, and this is already the end of the boot process. Now we will switch back to SSH. We disconnected from the serial console, and we are now going to access the box using SSH that we did before. And we will run the very first command that you usually run when you enter domain zero, which is xlist. It tells you the list of domains that are currently running. As we can see, we only have one domain running, which is DOM0, the initial domain, the first guest. And now we are going to create a CentOS 7 guest, also using the images available from upstream CentOS itself. We create a folder. And basically, we are going to download the pre-built CentOS 7 ARM 64-bit image, which is this one, is compressed, but it's just a regular image from CentOS upstream. Now we are going to decompress the image in order to use it. This is a raw file, it's not QCow or anything else, although we may use QCow or whatever you want. You can use VHD even if you want. Okay, and now we are creating the configuration file for the guest. We are specifying which kernel you want to use in order to boot the guest. This is the same kernel that we're using for DOM0, which is inside of the boot partition, so it's exactly the same kernel. And then we'll build a different guest image in order to have BFAT support inside of the guest. That's for UEFI. Actually, if you wanted to, you can also boot guest on ARM64 using UEFI directly with OBMF, which is the UEFI bootloader. We have support for that. And you could actually boot the guest using that instead of specifying a kernel on a RAM disk. Basically, here we have the kernel, the init RAM, the memory. We are telling the kernel the root, where to find it root disk. Whoops.
It was too fast.
Yeah, we have, as I said, we are telling the kernel which one is the root partition. We are assigning this guest one image only, which is the image that we just downloaded. We are assigning one vCPU, and we are telling the kernel also to output on the Zen console, which is HVC0. Okay, this is all done, and we can now save the file and create a new init RAM. This is modifying the builder for the init RAM, which is called Dracul, on CentOS, and we are adding the BFAT driver, which is basically support for FAT32 file systems. We are also telling the kernel to load the driver, and now we will rebuild the init RAM FS for the guest. Oops. We are telling Dracul which kernel version to use in order to build the init RAM FS, and we are also telling it the name that we want the init RAM FS to have. Now this is done, and we can create the guest. We use XL. Oops. Okay, we forgot to specify the name of the domain, so XL was complaining that the domain had no name. We are going to assign a name now, CentOS 7, save the file, and now we are going to create it using XL, XL create, minus C means guest, and finally we are passing the config file as the last argument. And this is the guest booting. And that you, well, you can see that it's starting all those services. We will have to wait in order to get a prompt. No, this is a prompt, and we can log in into the guest. It's also the same release. No surprises here, it's running on 64, basically the same. And we also only have one CPU assigned to this guest, so a CPU info is only going to contain information for one vCPU. And we also check the memory of the domain. As we can see, memory is 512 megabyte compared to kilobyte. That's the value that we get. Now we disconnect it from the guest, and we are back at DOM 0. If we do an Excel list, in this case, we'll see that we have two domains running. We have DOM 0, and we have the guest that we just created. Now we can attach back to the console. We'll shut down the guest. And finally, we'll convert this guest config file into a libbird file that you can use with libbird, which means that you can type, you can create a config file that you use with Excel and then convert it to use it with libbird. This is done using Birch. We are telling it the driver to you. Yeah, we are telling Birch to convert from native. We are telling the format of the original config file, which is ZenXL, and the name of the original config file. And now it will generate the XML that's used by libbird. As you can see, the Xen config file was much smaller, which is easier to type, rather than typing this straight into the console, which is much more harder. So you can create Excel config files and then convert them to XML in order to use them with libbird. This is the same config file. We have the domain type is Xen. We have the memory that we are assigning to the domain, the number of vCPUs, the type of domain, the kernel to use, the init RAM, the guest, the command line for the guest, which is this one. But there are other options here, like what to do when the guest reboots, or things like that. This is the image that we are going to use, and now we are going to create, well, to save the config file, because we didn't save it before, it was only shown on the console. So we are going to save it as centos7.xml. And finally, we create the guest, and now we are going to attach to the console. And that's the same guest, this time created using Birch instead of Excel. It's exactly the same guest, so the output is going to be exactly the same. It's the same release, it has the same number of vCPUs, so everything is exactly the same as it was before. Yeah. And that's mostly it. Any questions? Yeah.
How normal does it compare to x86? Do you have, like, for example, XL trigger to send a sysr to the client?
I think that you don't have trigger. You send all those actions using Xen store. I don't know if we are going to add trigger because ARM64 supports ACPI. And XL trigger, what actually does is it trigger ACPI methods, basically.
Yeah.
So I don't know if we are going to add it for ARM64.
I mean, the basic thing you need is just like triggering a sync, for example. That's often important. You want to do a backup or something like this.
To trigger, suspend, and resume, and things like that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't think we support that yet, because we don't have support for light migration on ARM yet.
The question is just like, is it intended to be there, or is the ARM different somehow?
No, we intend to support the same set of features. The command line is exactly the same, the Excel tool stack is exactly the same on ARM and x86, it's just that some options are not implemented on ARM yet, like light migration, for example, or safe restore, which is exactly the same. Safe restore is based on light migration.
Yeah.
Once we have that, we'll be able to save a VM, like you would say, do checkpointing and things like that on ARM also. Well, if there are no other questions, that's all for me. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Ojo.